Good afternoon, everyone. This is a pleasure for me to be in this workshop, a biomarker regulatory workshop. And thank you for the 3TR Consortium and for the Critical Path Institute for organizing such a workshop. My name is Nathalie Seigneuret. I'm a senior scientific project manager in IMI and a colleague of Isabella Tamanini, who is looking after the 3TR project. And as a background, I'm a doctor in pharmacist by training and having regulatory background. And before joining IMI, I used to work at the European Medicine Agency. In the next couple of slides, I will present you the IMI perspective on regulatory matters and show you how this is important and therefore how this workshop is very timely and welcome. So if we go back to what is IMI, we are building some innovative collaboration, joining all the different stakeholders to work and to foster research and innovation along the medicine life cycle to accelerate and optimize discovery and development of new treatments. So in this simple diagram, we can see that most of our projects are actually addressing a number of tools, methodologies that are really relevant in the regulatory framework, being biomarkers, endpoint, novel design, trial design, modeling simulation, etc. And of course, it's even more important as soon as we go more to the late stage development of medicinal product. So by essence, regulatory aspects are very important in our project. So what do we expect from our project? We expect them to deliver tangible results to contribute to the IMI objective. And if we look back at the objective from the regulation, we can see that there is already foreseen the fact that our project should develop diagnostic and treatment biomarkers for disease clearly linked to clinical relevance and approved by regulators. And even when we look at the last point, to improve the current development process by providing support to the development of tools, standards, approaches to assess efficacy and safety and quality of regulated health product. So again, it's inherent the regulatory aspect in the work that is carried out by your project. So to ensure the maximum impact of our project results for the patient's benefit, we really expect transformative outputs, such as tool methodology, that are uptaken by the relevant stakeholders, regulatory accepted when relevant, sustained, obviously, and ready for integration into healthcare system when relevant. So it's very important to understand that it's quite challenging, especially in our project, to address all that, especially when we have a limited timeline, limited resources, and when we know that the extent of data that might be needed in order to have biomarkers, to have endpoint, etc., regulatory accepted. However, even if we cannot have that, we need to really ensure that all the steps are taken in order that we are on the right trajectory to have this result at a certain point of time regulatory accepted. So since its inception, IMI has strongly encouraged the engagement of regulators and early dialogue to maximize the impact of the project outputs. So since the early days, we have really worked out in elaborating guidance to a consortia interacting with regulators, organize webinars, strengthening the template to ensure that in the full proposal and in the work plan, consortia are thinking from the start of having a strategy to interact with regulators. And as we know, having all this interaction not only include embedded tasks in the reg plan, but elsewhere foresee some resources because nothing is without the need to really work on this interaction in the work plan and as well in terms of resources money-wise, because as soon as you start some interaction with regulators, all this process costs money. We do have as well regulators represented in the IMI governance in our advisory group, the scientific committee. And actually the chair of our scientific committee is Professor Isabel Becker-Jandin, who is the head of division at the Pollination Institute. We do have as well a representative from the European Medicine Agency, being Corinne De Vries, and we do have another representative, Dr. Anna Ciotti, who is actually setting up at the Medicine Agency in Luxembourg. So again, in our governance, we do have emphasis on the regulatory aspect. From the start as well, IMI has been organizing regulatory science summit in collaboration with both EMA and FDA. And I will explain a little bit further what these meetings are about. Now, as you know, we had a midterm evaluation already of the IMI2 program to see how successful the program is and the initiative, the partnership. And actually, one of the recommendations of this midterm review was to continue the efforts to connect with patient organizations and regulatory agencies. We are expecting the full evaluation of the IMI2 partnership to start in 1 year, 1 year and a half. And we expect that, again, this aspect will be considered by the independent expert panel. So when I was talking about the objective and showing how ambitious they were, obviously it's very complicated in a five-year project or six-year project to really develop all these biomarkers, etc., tools, and to be regulatory accepted. But it's important to show that, to show again the success of the partnership, that we are on the trajectory to do so. And therefore, our governing board has agreed on a set of key performance indicators in order to measure the success of IMI. And one of the key performance indicators that we report annually is regard the regulatory acceptance of result. And this KPI is about how many new or improved guidelines, methodology, tool, technology, or solution are accepted by regulatory authorities for use in the context of R&D. So of course, it's broad to cover the broad type of project that we have in IMI. And that is measured by the number of formal qualification procedure completed, being letter of support that are issued by EMA, FDA, qualification opinion received, etc. So far, one can say that we have been quite limited in the number of qualifications we have resolved, but I'm sure that you know the effort that it takes. But we have an opinion for the project proactive on two patient-reported outcomes instrument to capture physical activity in patients with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease in clinical trial setting. We do have as well another project, PREFER, who just submitted a joint EMA UNITA qualification opinion on patient preference. And actually, this is the first time that we'll try this joint process, having both the health technology assessment aspect and the regulatory aspect in this qualification opinion. But we do have letter of support, many letter of support that have been issued for IMI2 project. We did have already for IMI1. I focus now on IMI2. I'm giving some example, EMS2 trial on autism, MobilizeD on digital mobility endpoint, MacuStar for clinical endpoint in age macular degeneration. So these letter of support are important because, again, it's to show that the consortia are on the right track to generate the result that hopefully will lead to at a certain point to qualification. Many of our projects as well have started to really interact with regulators by submitting their qualification advice, and we have qualification issued, and recently Inodia on diabetes received an advice on the master protocol for the trial that they have started, and letter of support of intent for biomarker qualification accepted as well by the FDA, like the LITMUS project. A number of projects as well interacted with the Innovation Task Force, organized or specific working parties, especially in the field of vaccines or antimicrobial resistance. Just Maybe of interest to you, we do have the project Articure as well, which is in autoimmune and rheumatoid arthritis, who is working on a white paper that is aimed to regulators to enhance the development of guidance document for the development of novel treatment and prevention of rheumatoid arthritis. And this white paper is going to be soon submitted to regulators. Finally, we do have a regulator's part of being actually partners in our project or an advisory board. Now, coming back to the Regulatory Science Summit, these are meetings co-organized with both EMA and FDA that we do on a regulatory on regular basis. And this is important meeting with the objective to provide input on the proposed research priorities and to get to understand as well what the regulators are needed in order to again maximize the transformation impact of IMI projects and to share as well the lessons on for better interaction. And the key messages from both meeting held in 2017 and 19 are available on the website. But what I was focusing here is more on again showing why it was so important to have this interaction early on to really make sure that we can integrate these innovative approaches developed by project into the regulatory pathways and to continue to have this scientific dialogue and regulatory dialogue to understand really the problems, the body of knowledge, and create proof of concept that really would inform the evolution of regulatory practice. Now, of course, with the evolution towards digital era, it's a little bit more complicated in the European environment versus the US environment, especially when we have to think of the different interplay between the different regulations that we have. And obviously that was the focus of the last meeting we had. And one of the recommendation was, or key messages was really that we will need to have gain experience on that and ensure continuous dialogue and certain good practice sharing to make sure that again we can really advance the field there. Our scientific committee, as I was saying, are advisory to IMI, and in their role of their advisory role, they give recommendation to a governing board on what they think would be important for improving and for making sure that our project are looking forward. And one of the observations that they did, especially our representative from the committee are attending the project review that are held usually at midterm of the project, as well as the closeout meeting. And what they have experienced or seen is that there is often hesitancy with regulatory involvement from consortia to engage with regulators. That may be too inexperienced, because obviously some academics, researchers are maybe less familiar with all this regulatory aspect. But we have as well the reluctance of regulators to participate in IMI too, often based on the perception that there might be a conflict of interest. And when new regulatory concepts are required, consortia often limit themselves to dissemination of information to regulators, but restrain from implementing regulatory research for providing the evidence that could justify the change in the regulatory practice. Based on this observation, the scientific committee elaborated some recommendations to improve the regulatory participation in IMI2, and these recommendations have been published on a website last June. Now, I won't go through all the recommendations, but I invite you to read those, because that can be of interest to you. But I want to focus on two recommendations that they made, is really to again show the importance of the regulatory aspects for AMI and the need to identify the relevant regulatory authorities for implementation of project outputs, which is crucial, and to understand the framework for implementation to define the strategy and engage as early as possible, especially when we have rapid evolving field and when we do have this complex interplay between the regulations. Having said that, in the different regulations that we have in Europe, and that the regulatory research is an important component of IMI and future partnerships. So these research questions really need to be well defined and addressed with the state-of-the-art research tool. And the overall goal, of course, of this research is to produce the scientific data that will be the basis for regulatory decision making. I won't go through the other recommendation because this is less relevant here for here. But one thing that is important that the group flagged was obviously that it's quite often that academics group and even patient groups may have less or maybe less familiar with the whole regulatory environment, while in industry, there is a much more familiarity with all the process and even the jargon. And therefore, being in public-private partnership like IMI, there is definitely a value here for having the assistance and the help of the industry experts within the consortium. One observation that I had as well is the fact that often the participation in scientific advisory board of one regulator or one representative is often ill-defined and is not the best option, and it's better to use all the available process that are available to start the interaction. Now, another aspect for us that was important, because as I said, in IMI2, we see, and especially since we have tried to further emphasize that in consideration of the regulatory strategy in the work plan, but we still do have a lot of consortia, especially from the earlier stage or earlier project that may not have this considered from the start, and therefore, there is still a need to provide some help to look at the regulatory acceptance. And therefore, we awarded this year a framework contract for services to support the regulatory acceptance of IMI results. And actually, this framework contract service was awarded to the Critical Path Institute, having a lot of experience in that space. So the objective for here is really to make sure that we can fully exploit all the IMI project results and that this can be used in the regulatory and in the R&D context, and that we do have a framework that can help other consortia to benefit from this expertise. So in conclusion, the regulatory research is really an important component of IMI, and therefore it's essential to have this regulatory strategy and engage with regulators to get early insight, anticipate challenges, and maximize the impacts. So the approach to progress our BD biomarkers is fully supported, and this workshop is really welcome. And obviously, we expect that this workshop being focusing on IBD will definitely help as well with the other disease area of TR. Now, there is certainly a need to strengthen the regulatory knowledge and ensure understanding of the regulatory pathways by all project partners. And again, having this kind of workshop is certainly an opportunity for everybody to be on the same page. And I give you some example that I'm following some project that obviously it took a little bit of while for some consortium member to understand why it was important and why it was this burden to actually start building or preparing all this document in order to go through the qualification procedure, because as I said, this process of preparing, submitting, going through this procedure of qualification is not trivial, and it really requires a lot of resources, not only again on person months, but as well resources financially. And therefore, it's important that everybody is on the same board from the consortium to really understand the importance of that. Now, there is a need to share the lessons about the different consortium, because most of the consortia now start having experience, some more than others, with interacting with regulators and to approach the qualification of endpoints, of biomarkers. And again, this workshop is an opportunity for in the IBD area, but again, it's important to see from the other disease area on what can be learned on from others. And for sure here as well, the companies sitting on different consortium can really bring a value here. And just to put a note, our project MobilizeD, even if it's in a different area since it's on digital health, but they have work on the and on their letter of support. And by that, some members have created a discussion channel on Slack called for D Health for Trials. And this is a channel, a discussion channel open to all. And the vision is to share the good practices for the qualification. Here it's focusing on digital health methodologies, but actually it's actually applicable in a way, or can be useful for all who are going through all this exercise. So again, this is very important, and therefore this workshop is very important, and I really look forward to the discussion among all the members and the collaboration with Critical Health Path Institute on all this aspect for successfully qualify the IBD biomarker. Thank you very much for your attention.